allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please remain standing for a moment of silence for the sick, the handicapped, pardoned, and military personnel in this community. Thank you.
Bill Henderson.
Here.
Bill Lyon.
Here.
Joseph Washington, Austin Peter, Bill Popwell, Joe Ricci.
Here.
Bert Cherry.
Here.
Greg Blasio.
Here.
Christopher McComas.
Here.
Engineer Slate.
Here.
Angela Collins.
Here.
Police Chief Jack King.
Here.
Fire Chief Bill Toyo.
Here.
Officer Dean Lefferts.
Here.
All right, we'll call our visitors up. First visitor, Gail Livingston.
Good evening.
Yep.
I'm here to talk about a situation that I've encountered, both from a distance and in person. I want to take a talk about the crosswalk that's down here at Railroad Street and Bower Hill Road. Okay? Everybody with me? The crosswalk. That crosswalk actually goes through the middle of that intersection. And there are times of the day when that intersection can be very difficult to cross. I've witnessed a lady in the crosswalk walking from north to south, walking from towards the beer distributor, walking towards Railroad Street. Halfway through that crosswalk, somebody coming up Railroad Street, cars are stopped on Bower Hill Road. And the person coming up Railroad sees that vehicles are stopped, go ahead, round that corner, and just about hit that lady. Okay? I've stood on that south side of that intersection, in the crosswalk, and it is just a horrendous place. I mean, you can stand there for 3 to 4 minutes, depending on the time of the day. If you're crossing from south to north, a beer distributor coming across, the sight lines for that, for our vehicles coming off Washington, out of town, I'll call it, they come down, there's a dip in the road here, they come up over that dip, people are watching, you know, drivers are watching for vehicles turning, they're not looking for pedestrians, okay? You come over that railroad tracks, and as soon as you're over that railroad tracks, they're in that intersection. First car may see you, but by the time they see a pedestrian in that crosswalk, they're not going to stop, especially if there's a line of cars behind them. By the time they stop, they've already crossed that crosswalk. There's a turning lane there coming into town. That turning lane, people will actually stop in that to make that left-hand turn onto Railroad Street. So it's a very difficult place to stand and try and cross traffic. And I don't think people drive through that intersection every day, they don't see a lot of pedestrians. They don't see a lot of activity north of Bower Hill Road to attract pedestrians. It's not like Washington Avenue downtown. Okay? You got crosswalks there, you got businesses on both sides, there's a lot of pedestrian traffic. You're basically trying to get across three lanes of traffic. If there's somebody turning, people coming on the other side, coming into town on Bower Hill, don't always necessarily see you if you're in the crosswalk until you're actually in that lane. So I've got two suggestions. Anybody got any questions before I?
No, this is not a new topic, but I'm curious about any suggestions.
First suggestion, really easy, fairly simple, relatively inexpensive. Get some crosswalk signs there. Okay? Put them, put one on a couple on Bower Hill or put one in the middle of either side of the crosswalk. I realize this time of year with snow removal, it gets to be a challenge, but you got to get people's attention. I mean, people coming down from Washington, they're looking to see if somebody's going to pull out in front of them or looking at left hand, they just blow right on by. They don't see people standing. The other suggestion is move that crosswalk. move it out of that three-way intersection. Move it the other side of the railroad tracks.
Like in front of Dairy Lane.
Front of Dairy Lane. You know, in the summertime, spring, summer, and I got here in June, we used to walk to Dairy Lane a lot, the summer and the fall. And there are times that, Dairy Lane parking lot is full, and people would park across the street and walk across. It's a challenge, but at least the sight lines are better there.
I think with, when we discussed this in the past, the issue with moving it there, because obviously that's would be seen as a logical place to put the parking lot, is on the other side, where the, on the other opposite side of the Dairy Lane, is not, there's no sidewalk there, so it's a crosswalk to nothing. So I think there's a liability issue there from my to where the crosswalk can legally go.
Well, there's a, yeah, this raises another question. You come down from Washington Avenue on the south side of Bower Hill, and that sidewalk ends
right
at the parking lot for the Veclen. Mm-hmm. Why didn't it continue? There's a,
basically what you got from the sidewalk is just parking lot. It's, but it's a private parking lot the rest of the way. There's no sidewalk. So it would be a matter of actually adding sidewalks all the way down to the crosswalk to make it so it goes to somewhere.
Sidewalks is a whole other issue.
I hear you.
That'll be another issue for another time. But I just, you know, you got to do something with that crosswalk.
What was your second recommendation?
Move it.
Move the crosswalk. First recommendation, put signs on it to make it better. Okay. You know,
The crosswalk signs, like what we do.
Is there a problem? Are we allowed to put a crosswalk from a private lot to a private lot?
That's, I think that was the issue when we looked at it.
That was the problem.
What's that?
That was the problem.
Yeah, that was the
issue. And then you're putting a crosswalk here, then you're telling people from their delay is the park.
Yeah.
At Tampa Lee's lot, basically, he's saying people are parking over there, but it's private parking.
Yeah. First time from. Yes, Pat.
Yeah. The issue between parking lot and parking lot, I don't think the issue is so much of what we're connecting, because we're connecting, you know, two sides of our street. Okay? The problem that I saw before was that we were encouraging people to park in what was Tambellini's parking lot and walk over to
Well,
that was the idea.
If
we were to put a crosswalk would we not then be encouraging that behavior?
Yeah, that's reality.
Reality
is one thing. Okay, if that was your parking lot, you own a business, and we put a crosswalk going into your parking lot, and then somebody pulled out of your business, got hurt, and you'd be like, why were you directing people to come walk into my parking lot?
We weren't.
This
brings up another question. We have a set of stairs that comes up to that parking lot.
From a dead-end sidewalk.
No, I know. But it comes, if you cross from what's now rail yard across to the parking lot, you come up the steps, you're now then, you know, in their parking lot, but that's also part of our right-of-way. Okay? My question is, could we not connect our two sides of the street?
We put a walkway from the sidewalk.
You can extend your sidewalk if you wish. It's within the road right away.
Perhaps if we looked at just doing what we have the ability to do, which is put a crosswalk from one side of our street to the other side of our street, and look, people will do what people do.
And correct for tourism.
Well, hopefully they'll stop.
There's a crosswalk, a sidewalk that comes up railroad on the west side across the street from the beer district that ends at that stairway.
Yeah.
Why not just wrap it around?
I believe, Mr. Chairman, you may need some kind of study over there before you do that.
We will first
know you got something.
Right.
So I would immediately.
Can we look at each
other? Can we see
where we could put, continue that sidewalk from there to, and then we can see the legality of it, whether or not it can be done.
Yeah.
If it's in your right of way, it can be done.
I think no matter where you put it, it's going to be a difficult situation. So I like the first recommendation, to be quite honest with you. Yes, at least more awareness, whether it's blinking signs, whatever, you know, you see these pedestrian signs in different areas.
I walk down here all the time, and I go to work. I never use the crosswalk. I cut across the tracks and stuff. But, you know, if I get hit by a car, I'm like, it's on me. You know, that's why the crosswalk goes from the sidewalk down there, and then the sidewalk up there. And,
I can get pedestrians.
If you like, I can shed some light on some just numbers going off the sheer memory without having my computer in front of me. I can speak for the last 18 years. I can only think of one pedestrian that we had struck in that area, and he was crossing Railroad Street. That was, so I know McLeod handled that, Chief McLeod handled that, so that had to be 15 years ago. Other than that, we had a pedestrian walking, not paying attention with his head down. He may have just crossed or was crossing the crosswalk you're speaking of, and he actually walked into the ladder that was being hauled by a pickup truck because he wasn't looking where he was going. His head hit the ladder. But we've not had a pedestrian get run over in the 18 years I can think of at that location. I understand your concerns. Now, there is an extra lane that was added last year for the traffic to turn down Railroad Street, but at least where the crosswalk is now, you at least have a stop sign on Bower Hill Road to stop the incoming traffic, and you have stop signs on the roads coming from Union and Liberty Street, which they have to stop. So there is some form of control there, but it's also, you know, the pedestrians have a duty and responsibility that they're not supposed to set foot in that crosswalk until it's clear to do so. That may be difficult during rush hour, but that is the rule that you have to follow as a pedestrian. You just don't step into the roadway and expect everybody to stop.
No.
It must be clear.
But on the other hand, I mean, to stand in that crossway, you can stand there for 5 minutes some days. And cars will turn from Railroad Street and just run right across that curb.
I know.
I just, you know, it's one of those things that it's a safety issue. And I just want to make sure, we've had a couple of close calls because people aren't reported. It doesn't mean we don't have close calls.
Are you saying the problem is at the stop sign at Bower where it's two lanes? Or are you saying it's by the beer distributor where it's wider? Where are they crossing?
The crosswalk comes from Railroad Street across through, it crosses the going outbound lane going out away from Washington, and then there's two lanes. There's a turn lane coming in, and then there's also a travel lane.
There's actually two there, right? One down by Bower Hill where it's two lane,
right.
And then the other one where you're talking about. So there are actually two different areas of crossing. But
so can you get public safety and chief and kind of see a couple options?
Yeah,
obviously the quickest and the simplest would be the signs, but if there's a better way to direct sidewalk.
Yeah. And I mean that crosswalk, the crosswalk down there right at the stop sign at Bower Hill.
Right.
But that one's been paved over and the lines are kind of, but that's certainly another way to walk out of your way to get across the road, especially if you're coming this way. Right. Thank you for your time.
Thanks.
Thanks.
All right. Mary Weiss.
I don't know. It's been new here. And I hope you all did have a good New Year. They said one coming out from Gettysburg, which everybody stops at the walkway or something. That's where I first noticed it, was in Gettysburg. Those people stop on a dime. They're going 2 and 3 miles an hour through the heart of town that you can get across the street. It's really neat. But anyway, we came through terrible, terrible fog, and I was very happy to get out of the fog and get home. Tomorrow night, we have a special over at the railroad station, and it is, we're hoping it won't snow, because we snowed out in November or December, but it is, again, C.P. Mayor Sr. brought in the industrial park, where GE Company is, Landry Bolt was, all that area, and across the street is where he made his bricks. and it's a very interesting development of how he ever got into it. Tomorrow night, that's at 7 o'clock. Then at the end of January, speaker, the end of February, speaker, it's on Sunday afternoons. If you could just pass those out to everyone. Thank you. The speaker coming up at the end of January, we've heard before. For a retired minister, he certainly loves war stories and war heroes, and that's what is coming up at the end of January. And those two, January and February, are Sunday afternoons. We older people don't want to get ice or snow and get it in the dark. And so at the last program we had a tremendous history lesson by Curtis Copeland Jr. The history that he gave us was far superior to any I'd ever heard before, about every move that brought on Korea, and the fact that his father, a medical assistant trained, ended up in the front lines with a rifle. That was Korea. But there were over 110 people. We quit counting on the way. Thank you for your help, because those people were coming in every direction. On my trip to Ligonier, and I just want to pass this on to the borough, because I know you're meeting with the parking authority. And also, I wanted to go on to the parking authority, so I'll probably write them a letter. In Ligonier, small town, busy street, they have the meters everywhere along the main street of town, which is 10, 12, 14 blocks long. But on the first block away from it, I don't know if the sign said 15 or 25 minutes free parking. They have it all around the business district. That's just my suggestion to be passed on to the parking authority. And as far as the history people, we still have a few of these left. If you want one, let me know. Thank you very much. Hope to see you tomorrow night. If not, hope to see you the last Sunday of this month.
Thank you.
Thank you, Barry. Eric Schmidt, please.
I just have a quick request. Could you put the recycling rules for cardboard in the next newsletter? I think I complained about this last year, and I have some neighbors about it. So we're really going to keep out what they take and what they take. I still have all kinds of Christmas.
14.
I'm definitely under that, but yeah. I'll crush them and cut them up some more. But it seems like once a month, I've got a garbage shirt in my driveway because they didn't take it.
I like the rules too myself, because I never throw my cardboard away.
Yeah.
I'm like, we can recycle that, right?
Yeah, I don't like that too.
Yeah, they're required to be just 14 by 14, and anything else they won't take.
How big is a case of beer? It's bigger than 14 by 14.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you would have thought they just let the brakes around.
All right, thank you. All right, on to the regular meeting. Minutes. Motion of the Borough of Commons regarding the minutes of December 12, 2016 public hearing as submitted. Mr. Ricci and Mr. Anderson, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Carried. Motion of the Borough of Commons regarding the minutes of December 12, 2016 regular meeting as submitted.
Second.
Bruce and Milligan, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Was that you?
No. I was him the first one.
Oh, no, sorry.
I'm trying to throw you all around.
Control twist. Appointment of the Borough Solicitor. Motion of the Borough Council regarding the appointment of Hans Trucci, and Nicholas PC as the Borough Legal Consultants for the calendar year of 2017.
So moved.
Second. Bart Cherry and Bruce Gullery. All those in favor? All those opposed? Motion carries. Appointment of the Borough Engineer. Motion of the Borough Council regarding the appointment of the
Gateway Engineers Incorporated as the consulting engineers for the calendar year 2007.
I will move.
I'll second.
All right, very good. Joe and Bill Henderson, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carried.
Thank you very much.
2017 Bridgeville Borough Sanitary Sewer Contract B Line Contract. Bids were advertised and publicly opened on Friday, December 9th, 2016, 10 a.m. in the public chambers for the 2017 Bridgeville Borough Sanitary Sewer Contract B Lining with the following bid results. A Pipe Services, 10% bid bond, amended yes, $246,535. Inside Pipe Company, 10% bid bond, amended yes, $248,866. And in Studiform, 10% bid bond, amended yes, $304,825. Motion the Borough Council rejecting the bids for the 2017 Sanitary Sewer Contract B. Lining contract due to budget constraints per the recommendations of engineer Sykes and manager Collins.
So moved.
Bart and Bruce, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Seventeen Bridgeville Borough Sanitary Sewer Contract C, CCTV and Inspection. Bids were advertised and publicly opened on Friday, December 9th, 2016, at 10 a.m. in the Council Chambers for the 2017 Bridgeville Borough Sanitary Sewer Contract C. In inspection with the following bid results. Motion of the Borough, I'm sorry, AAA Flexible Pipe, 10% bid bond, amended yes, $71,289.50. State Pipe Services, 10% bid bond, amended yes, bid of $71,470.25. Insight Pipe, 10% bid bond, amended yes, $77,296. And Robinson Pipe Cleaning, 10% bid bond, amended yes, at a bid of $126,359. Motion of Borough Council regarding the award of the bid to the lowest responsible bidder, AAA Flexible Pipe, in the amount of $71,289.50, contingent upon review of all required documentation by engineer Sykes.
I'll second.
All right, Bruce and Bill, any discussion? Pat?
Yes, please. I would ask the council reject this contract. Newer camera technology is available. That newer technology handles laterals and main lines. This contract would represent a waste of $71,000 taxpayer dollars. I understand that we have an operations and maintenance plan for our sewer system. But that operations and maintenance plan does not take into account newer camera technology that is available. It is some amazing stuff. Okay? That they can not only look at the main line, but that they can look at laterals as well. In order to incorporate that additional scope, it is going to take some time for the borough to look at laterals, how they want to deal with the main lines, and what kind of bid specifications need to be done. Yes, it would be pushing off the video inspections until late 2017, early 2018. But it is much better to do that than to waste $71,000 taxpayer dollars on doing something that can wait a bit. We have cambered our entire community. I'll bet some of it is as old as 1994. I am not opposed to cambering. I just think we should make use of the newer technology. Other point. older camera technology, they clean the line before they sent the camera through. This newer camera technology, Dormont Borough, found that they could send the camera through and then decide to clean. They saved 80% of their cleaning budget. Okay? So not only the camera, the cleaning budget can be reduced. I would ask you to please reject these bids, save these taxpayer dollars.
President, can we ask the engineer's opinion on this?
Yes, sir.
You know, reviewing this information, there are certain requirements that we're supposed to follow relative to the O&M plan that's in place relative to the consent decree. We're required to videotape any sewer that is greater than 8 inches every 5 years. And we're required to videotape any sewer that is 8 inches or less once every 10 years. We have a we have some videotape that is old as 1994 on some of these sewers. I'm not gonna make any excuses as to why it wasn't videotaped, but I think it was just a matter of something, a few of these segments slipped through the cracks. Last year, we did not do any videotaping of the sewer system in the borough because all of the efforts and budgets that was established was put forth to make repairs on Washington Avenue in conjunction with the work that PennDOT and Pennsylvania American Water did to make upgrades and improvements to Washington Avenue between St. Clair Street and Chartier Street. So we spent a considerable amount of money there. That was, you know, all part of the O&M plan, but you know, we had to seize the moment to take care of that work. There's other, so since all the work was focused on one segment of pipe last year, the other segments of the pipe in the borough did not get any work done a lot. The video, the CCTV work that we're performing is to take care of 2016 and 2017 to be in compliance with the O&M plan with regards to the DEP requirements. I think if we defer doing anything, we have 3 years worth of videotaping to do. And the other thing is, you know, we take this information from the CCTV inspection and review it, and if there are level 4 and level 5 based on the NASCO coding system that's in place, those are the ones we put in the upcoming year's repair contract. As I may have said in the past to many of you here on council, I'll repeat it again. While we have the contractor in town doing this CCTV work, we make it very clear to them at a pre-construction meeting that if you find any level 4, level 5 defects that may have a serious implication of resulting in a backup or a flooding of sewage into someone's home, let us know immediately while we have our contractor in town who's doing the other repairs, so that we can save money and have him do that work, as I often call it, the proverbial 3 o'clock Friday afternoon repair. We don't want to have those repairs. Doing this preventative O&M maintenance prevents us from having those emergencies. Will we have emergencies? Yes, we still have, but we're trying to minimize them. So the TV of the sewer inspection is required. We're required to make the repairs. The lining of the sewers, that can be delayed a year until we get caught up with other things. So I would suggest we move forward. With regards to looking at people's laterals, I think that the borough has to put a good forth effort if they so desire to inspect people's laterals. I know there's other communities who have lateral inspection ordinances in place. And I think it would behoove us to probably get some examples of those, not only of our local communities like South Bay and Collier, but you know, other communities at Gateway Road. I can get us examples of their ordinances. So I think, you know, we have a lot, you know, big task ahead of us with regards to the inspection of the laterals. That's something that I think the DEP and the local government at the county level would like to see us do, maybe as a demonstration project. And I think we should use 2017 as a time to embrace and work on the lateral ordinance.
So the example of that would be if they were selling
it? That's an example, yes. If you could do that, another
another thing could be that we could maybe take the borough and break it up into zones. Maybe we break it up into 5 or 8 zones or districts, and we do the laterals in those districts. Maybe we do that as part of the, you know, the, like I said before, the 5 and the 10 year cycle. So,
Joe, what you're suggesting is upon closing, prior to closing,
yeah, work. Yeah, that's really good.
Yeah,
they've done that too. So, I mean, there's some options out there on how we want to handle this.
Okay.
Well, I would say I object the idea that that's waste.
Right.
And I think that the plan that is in place is a good idea for our community.
Question on the motion.
Mr. Sykes?
Yes.
The place where we agree is in perhaps dividing us and taking and doing the town in a matter of zones and perhaps doing some inspections as we're going through, and that we need time to look at this, how best to implement it. Councilman Henderson?
Yes.
The reason that I believe it is a waste of taxpayer dollars is because when you camera both the main line and the lateral, which, as the engineer pointed out, we see this requirement coming down. Okay? If our plan in 2018 is to camera both the laterals and the main lines in a section of our community, if we change, because that operations and maintenance requirement is a requirement we established as a community. That's our plan that was designed by our engineer and passed by our council. Not external. Am I correct in that?
You are correct, Pat, in the fact that it's not an externally approved, let me finish first, okay? We prepared the O&M plan. It was reviewed by the DEP and it was implemented, okay? The O&M plan is often up for audits and is also up for making improvements to it so that as we move forward with the plan, it's an evolving systematic way of operating and maintaining the sanitary sewer system. So, you know, there's no mandate to do lateral testing at this time?
No.
Okay. So, you know, let's work on getting something in place, and if someone forces our hand to do it, we're already there.
Yeah, and that's, the vast majority of the communities have not pulled the trigger on that.
Right.
The regulators have highly suggested that they would like that as one of the menu items on your round of things to do. And this round of things in terms that not just our engineering firm, but firms across and communities across the county have, at least in this round, discovered for the demonstration project purposes, they were coming up with things that were better bang for the buck in the short term than the lateral testing. There's many reasons to proceed in one way or another way, or at one time or another time with those. I think the manager and the engineer and I indicated we're happy to sit with you guys in the board and committee to talk those sorts of things through. But I see the lateral thing, I think, like Joe and Lori, is a separate thing from what we are ongoing. You know, how to and whether to and the timing of the whole lateral testing program is part of your future is a valid topic, but a separate topic from the immediate. Certainly this contract letting for the purposes of helping Joe and Lori to keep up on the ongoing consent decree requirements that they continuously balance off the year.
We have more repairs than we have money for. And before we keep up with looking for repairs, there are more things that we can fix on the list already. Again, Mr. Henderson, the reason I look at this as a waste is because as we move forward and we have to go to do something with the laterals, or for that matter, as Alcosan comes in and moves forward and done something with the laterals, the money, the $71,000 that we spend today to camera main lines would be a byproduct of a proper cameraing that would be done in 2018 with the laterals included. Remember, the camera that they work with is called a lamp. a lateral and maintenance probe. Okay, the reason they call it lateral and main, I'm sorry, not lateral and maintenance, lateral and mainline probe, is because it cameras both the lateral and the mainline at the same time. That's why they're somewhat together.
I watched it. I saw the video, and I I love the technology. It's a great concept, but I don't think it's not here right now. I mean,
The concept is here.
The concept's
been out there since 2014.
We're not prepared to implement it here.
As a community, we're not prepared for it. And that's why I'm saying reject these bids today, get prepared for it, and let something out in 2018 that is going to wisely use that $71,000. Yep. That's why I'm saying reject it today.
Let me clarify one thing for you guys just for discussion's sake, that, and I think Joe indicated, there is two ways, more than two ways, but two little ways that you could implement a lateral testing program is either the more prominently used time of sale ordinances, which is the same as your dye testing.
Right.
That's what is slowly but surely coming into vogue. Right. In South Bay and different places, right. And other places, and probably will be coming to a neighborhood near you elsewhere as this thing progresses. That's different from doing a program where you say, like Joe said, okay, we're going to take sectors and break them up and then systematically go in, not at time of sale, but just independently get the data and then, I assume, force folks to do their things to enter.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when all
wait a minute, what do you mean by that?
Well, that's
the other shoe that drops.
Hold on.
That's the other shoe.
So, Joe, if something needs to be done, what happens?
Well, I think that's where, if it's discovered, if we would take the borough and break it up into zones, and you find that something has to be done with that ladder on somebody's house, you need to have the mechanism in place to tell them, first of all, you have to make the repairs to this lateral so it's a watertight system, and second of all, here's the time frame in which you have to complete the work, and third thing, if you don't do the work within the specified time frame, you're going to be, there's going to be fines and penalties for your incompletion of it. So that's, you know, it's something, it has to be done. I mean, the point of sale, that puts a burden on the seller. But.
Which is just like your other, your
dye test. Your dye test, right. So.
It sounds more expensive than a dye test.
It's basically the same thing they went through in the early 90s, late 80s, early 90s.
Right.
With the stormwater, removing the stormwater from.
Correct.
And we did that back then, broke it up into different sections, right, in the borough. You're going to be doing the same thing with the laterals as far as inspecting them.
If you did it on a sector yeah, approach like, right, that.
Well, that's if you go that way. And back then, I remember in the late 80s, there was such an outcry because it was being done, but we were mandated to do it. So we had to pick it up in the 90s. And go in and do it. And we worked with several people that had systems. They had put pumps in, right, and everything else. But it was a bullet that had to be bitten at the, right, time. And it did. And that's the same thing we're going to be confronted with in the future. But you go to tell somebody they got to spend $30,000 to dig your sores up from the house out, you better be prepared. So.
And there's no, right now we're not mandated to do it.
Anything.
So it would be a little hard to tell someone.
Do something they don't have to do.
Right. Right. And the regulators haven't met. I mean, the regulators may offer some assistance. Who knows?
Well, yes, and they may end up, technically right now, the laterals are private, our public lines, our public lines that we're responsible for. It may be that when they start, the due diligence is being done right now on a massive scale to figure out what the kind of next phase of this, mm-hmm, consent decree, there may be, and to help me out, John, there may be a design where they end up saying, you know what, if you look at it as one big plumbing system from here all the way down to Alcasand and everything in between, they may come up with one plan where it's, what we call like crap and trade, where you end up fixing bigger parts of your plumbing system. You know it's leaking here, you know it's leaking there, you know it's leaking everywhere, but you get a bigger bang from the buck if you can fix this portion, mm-hmm, of your toilet, so to speak, okay? That may be and end up where some communities go. That is why, actually, some have kind of held back on getting full steam into that ordinance or this fix or the other, because we really still want to do diligence for the next, what, year and a half, year or so, it's going to kind of have that other shoe drop. You really not bending the arc that much on the lab, you know, on your flow reduction, whether something happens this year, or next year, or 2 years, because of the kind of sale ordinance, it is a kind of slow drip fix. It's slowly over time as properties flip that, you know, happens.
So the main goal of this is to stop the infiltration of water into the sewer system.
Correct.
It's not sanitary sewer liquids getting into the ground. It's basically rainwater and water getting into the sewer system. That's the main purpose. It's not like we're going out there going, there's a health hazard or anything. It's taking out the infiltration of water. So just so that people don't think we're overlooking sanitary sewer problems as far as that.
And you know, it's not to say that there's technology out there that can correct these laterals. I mean, if the lateral is intact and in good shape, you can put a liner in it. I think they call it a top hat liner, where the machine comes through there, puts the liner in, and then flakes it into the lateral. And I think we had them in one day, and I think they can go 150 or 200 feet with this high top liner, and then you line the main one too. So there's other ways to do it.
We are lining the main lines, and we are doing all that.
We're not doing any lining this year.
No, but I'm saying we're going to.
We've been doing it.
Yes.
There's also a thought that as more communities get into it, they fall 83 or jumping into the other majority of the 83 at one time, there's going to possibly be more
pressure
for the community help that comes with it from different sources and whatnot. And having said that, the vast majority have implemented, whether it's now, a year from now, 2 years from now, 3 years from now, most have done ton of sale type models, not ton of them. Sector type model. So back to your point today, I don't believe you're probably pushing down the road what they need people in anyway, because that's probably going to be too simple on the tracks.
Okay.
As you can see the discussion here, there's a lot of unknowns about how laterals and main lines would be tested or videoed going forward, which is again why I suggest that you reject this work.
We're not prepared to do laterals right now. We're going to stay with our plan and continue.
I understand what you're planning on doing. I am asking you to go down a different course, to delay that until you can incorporate all of the information you've discussed here tonight into a plan that takes into account that new technology, that newer technology, all of what you've discussed. And by the way, you have lots of work to do. You just rejected the lining contract because it wasn't in, you didn't have enough money. There's a lot of work you can do without having to go down a path of cambering just main lines. I'd throw one last piece out. Alcasan has been talking about regionalization of interceptor lines. I noticed something. Alcasan came down and recambered all of the line that goes from point C5310 up to South of the Village. We had just cambered that. They completely redid it. Am I incorrect in this? Did they not?
We cambered it and cleaned it because we were getting back up into the home. So
yes.
It had to be done.
It had to be done. But they came in a year later or 2 years later and recambered the whole thing because that's what they wanted to do as part of their regionalization. I come back to the same thing. If we reject these bids, if we reject this contract, it doesn't mean that, you know, we gives us time to figure out a better way of accomplishing the goal of not having our, you know, overflows. So, yes.
We'll see.
So
This is the beyond compliance with our operation and maintenance.
And what would be the consequence of that?
We don't know. I don't think we want to find out.
Can we modify our operations?
You can't, right? I mean, you can't modify the cater.
I've made as passionate an argument as I can make for not doing this as I can.
All right. There's a motion, a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Comcast cable franchise renewal agreement. Motion of the Bridgeville Borough Council regarding the renewal of the cable franchise agreement between Comcast and Bridgeville Borough. Cohen Law Group has acted on behalf of the borough through the renewal process. The new agreement remains within the term of the agreement currently in place. Public hearing was held on January 9, 2017 at 6:30 to receive public comment.
So moved.
Bill?
Second.
And Bruce, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed?
Can I make a comment on this one?
Yes.
There are a number of sections in the franchise agreement. Just to the public, if Comcast isn't answering your phone calls, if they're not fixing their problems, you have recourse and the borough is available to hear your complaints. So that's one of the advantages of the franchise agreement.
Bill Bowman. Borough Council regarding the December 2016 final bill list.
I'll move.
Second. And Bert, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Motion of the Borough Council regarding the January 2017 bill list.
I'll move.
Joe?
Second.
And Bruce? All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. Payrolls. Motion for the Council approve the payrolls of January 13, 2027, and February 3rd, and February
10,
2017.
So moved.
Second. Bert and Bruce, all those in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. Monthly reports. Motion accept and pay commissions due December 2016 real estate tax collector report.
I'll move.
Joe?
Second.
And Bruce, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Motion to accept the November 2016 financial report.
Aye.
Joe?
Second.
And Bruce, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Motion to accept the December 2016 police report.
So moved.
Second. Bill and Bert, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Motion to accept the December 2016 zoning report.
So moved.
Second. Bill and Bert, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Real estate tax returns. Motion to Borough Council regarding the following real estate tax refund due to changes in assessments as requested by the real estate tax collector. Year 2016, lot block 255-P-319 for the amount of $488.33 to Richard and Judy Soltes. Year 2015, lot block 255-P-319 for $488.33 for a total of $976.66. And then year 2016, lot block 255-8-262 for $92.95. And year 2015, lot block 255-8-262 for $292.95 for a total of $185.90 to Twin Property Solutions. And then year 2015, lot block 255-H-173 for a total of $285.13 to SJ Group.
So
Copies of the official change orders have been provided for review.
So moved.
Bert?
Second.
And Bruce, all those in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. Committee reports. Administration. Finance, Joe?
I do not have a report.
All right, Parks and Rec, Joe is not here. Public Works?
No report.
Report. Public Safety, Bill?
Report.
No report. I think you've heard enough from me this evening.
Thank you, Pat.
You're welcome.
Police Chief?
Thank you, Council President. I just have some quick numbers to throw out, year-end numbers from last year, just giving an idea where we spent most of our time. Again, around Rite Aid, we were there 181 times for calls, and we ended up making 76 arrests at Rite Aid last year. Majority of those were for retail theft. We also had, on a separate note, 40 individual drug arrests last year in the borough. So, again, just some quick numbers, and Rite Aid led the pack again.
Did you get an award?
That's it.
Solicitor?
Thank you. My written report for tonight, I would recommend, I had distributed the summary and the RFP for the traffic study to vet the Cook School neighborhood concept plan. Would recommend a motion to authorize the manager and solicitor to put out that RFP to traffic study firms.
Is there a motion to send that out to bid?
Or we're going to send that?
No, to authorize us to.
Authorize to.
Yeah. Well, sorry, prepare it. It would authorize us to actually distribute it and seek the proposals from the head of the contracts. So we can do that one.
So I make a motion?
So moved.
I'll second.
All right. Bert and Bill, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you. That's all I have.
Engineer Sykes.
Thank you, Mr. President. The only thing that I have on my report that has been there before, we've discussed the CCTV and foot repair contracts at length. Bower Hill Road, we get in contact with People's Gas and get them on board to help share in the cost for the resurfacing of that section of Bower Hill Road where the gas line was installed. So we'll work with T.A. Rawls once the spring is here to do that. The Walk Around Park Phase 2 has been working on the design of mini golfers for Phase 2 improvements in the Walk Around Park. We want to get the information submitted within the next 2 weeks for DCNR approval prior to the project being placed out for bid. We're still anticipating a winter bidding for this project so we can get a spring start and get those improvements done. The Washington and James Development, nothing new to report. Since our meeting with the architect on September 22nd, they're waiting for the design standards to be finalized before they'll make any submission to the borough. And then the Chartreuse Street, Washington Avenue, Chartreuse Creek Ridge intersection. Roy and I have been invited to a meeting at PennDOT later this month to have a more of a status update on what PennDOT is with the design of the improvements. And I guess with that time, we'll get a schedule provided as to when it'll be let out for bid.
Yeah, and they want to know, they want to confirm with us that we received the $300,000 that we have the $253,000 in escrow.
Okay.
So that
they move forward. So,
okay. Have we received it?
Oh,
$300,000?
The DCNR has all of our paperwork and they're fine with everything. So,
yep.
We'll be. It may be a drawdown type type ones, but
yeah.
Everything is approved mm-hmm. and received in your office.
That's all I have to report on that.
I have a question, because during the week between Christmas and right around that area, I don't know if you know, Laura, somebody wiped out the wall in the park.
Yeah.
Do we have to put something together as an estimate?
I actually talked to the insurance company a couple weeks ago, and I talked to the insurance adjuster today, and he will actually be down there tomorrow.
Okay.
So.
Yeah, then.
So he'll be giving us.
We'll get a nice new wall, because he took out a big chunk.
He'll be giving us an estimate as far as what he feels, and we can also, he told me, get an estimate so we can take a look and see how far off we are there. So that will, he'll be down there tomorrow.
Okay.
Mike, just one comment on that Washington and James development. Any idea where we're at with the road design standards?
Washington and James.
That's a building down there at the corner, I mean.
The fence.
Planning commission, yeah, it's in planning commission and nothing back there.
They're working, they've been meeting, and I think they've had a couple of meetings so far, and have been working.
All right, Archie.
Thanks, Mr. President. We have my reports, I gave you two, one with the year end. We ended the year with 193 calls. We are down from last year, and we are not complaining about that. We'll take that. That's about it. Thank you.
Thank you. South Bridge, nothing to report.
Pleasure.
Becky's not here. Our manager. Old business. New business?
So I have Bridgewell Athletic Association has asked me to remind everyone that they had their first registration this past Saturday. They will have another registration this coming Saturday from 10 to 1 on the 14th, and then they'll have a Thursday the 19th. They'll have registration for baseball from 3 years old all the way up to 19 years old, and that Thursday time frame I think is 6 to 8. And they have selected or worked with the fire department on their annual bingo fundraiser is March 12th, Sunday.
All right. Not nice. Do you also have any business? You have one thing real quick. If you guys can look at your schedule between now and our next meeting, we have another meeting. We've been talking about a lot of stuff at the end of last year, this year with the laterals, kind of like go over our 2017 plan, what we want to implement and try to get in for next year. So at the end of the next year, we'll have we're not saying, hey, let's try to push this in and try to do that. We've already got a great plan. So, kind of go out, find a date, we'll advertise the meeting.
So do you want like
workshop. Yeah. Under this committee of planning for next year, he put together
with everyone.
Yes.
Everybody.
I make a motion we amend
that.
All right.
Second.
All right. Don't forget to grab your shirt.